Hello students, so students, in the previous part we have started with the new chapter of your syllabus, chapter number 11, and the name of the chapter is Enhancement of Food Production. So what are we exactly studying in this chapter? We are studying the different ways and different means which are required to improve the food production in the country. And when we speak about the improvement of the food production, we mean both quantity wise as well as quality wise improvement of food production. Now this demand, it can be met by using two methods. It can be done by plant breeding method or it can be done by animal breeding method. So by far in this chapter we have studied about plant breeding method. We have studied what is plant breeding, the basic idea about it. We have seen the advantages of plant breeding. Then we also studied about the green revolution that took place in India. We studied about the methods of plant breeding, where we studied hybridization and its technique as the first method. So we have seen four types of hybridization techniques. It can be intravarietal, interspecific and intergeneric. Then we studied the main steps that are involved in the plant hybridization process. So there are five steps. The first step is collection of variability, where we collect the species and the relative species of the already cultivated species. And this collection is known as germplasm collection. It can be done by in situ conservation or it can be done by ex situ conservation. After this, in the next step, that is evaluation and selection of parent, here from the germplasm that you have collected, two plants are selected as parent plants, and these plants are then sold for about 3 to 4 generations to obtain a complete pure line. Okay, now there are three features that the parent plant should hold in order to be selected. It must be healthy, it should be vigorous, that means it should be active and full of strength, and it should show desirable but complementary features. That means the parent plant that has been selected should show desirable characters, it should have desirable characters, but those characters have to be complementary to each other. That means it has to be not same but complementing each other, so that when both are mixed and the third product is produced, the third product has to be better than the parent plant. Okay, so it should show desirable but complementary features. Now after selecting the parent and selfing it for about 3 to 4 generations to obtain a pure line, the third and the most important step is carried, that is hybridization. Now over here, the selected parent plant, that is the female parent plant and the male parent plant, is taken and controlled pollination is carried. What happens in controlled pollination? The pollen grains from the male parent plant is artificially dusted on the female, the stigma of the female parent plant. Okay, this is controlled pollination. After controlled pollination, this process is followed by seed and fruit formation. Now the seeds that are obtained after this controlled pollination, they represent the hybrid generation. Okay, and from these seeds, the first progeny, the F1 progeny, is obtained, and then again from the F1 progeny is selected, it is evaluated to have desired combination of characters. Okay. Then comes the fourth step, where selection and testing of superior recombinant is done. Now from the F1 hybrid plants that are grown, from these plants, such plants are taken which are showing superiority over the parent plant and which are showing hybrid vigor, you know, like high hybrid vigor, which have good strength and good, you know, activity. So such plants are selected and again they are sold for about 3 to 4 generations. And they are sold till the time the homozygous uniformity is maintained and it is received. So they are sell for about 3 to 4 generation to again obtain a pure line, a homozygous line of a desired characters till the proper state of uniformity. And then comes the last stage where testing is done and then releasing and commercialization is done. So the new selected line are now evaluated for their productivity. That means how much of the yield do they produce. Then they are also screened and evaluated for the features like their disease resistance quality, pest resistance quality, and the quantity again, how much of the quantity of product do they produce. Now initially, the selected line of plants, they are grown under controlled conditions in the labs. Okay, like with proper controlled condition of water, fertilizers and everything. And then their performance is recorded. Okay, after that, the same selected line are now grown into a natural field for about 3 to 4 generations. So they are grown in different agroclimatic zones, in different climatic conditions. Okay, and finally, the new variety is released and then it can be used by the farmers and the commercialization can be done. So this is the process of hybridization that we studied. Then we also studied about certain Indian hybrid crops which are grown in India. So we studied about wheat and rice crops, the hybrid crops, then hybrid sugarcane. Then we studied about millets, the hybrid maize, jawar and bajra that is grown in India. And we studied about some disease caused to the plants and the disease resistant plants which are developed and grown in India. Now in this particular session, we will be starting with the mutation breeding. Before we start with mutation breeding, we need to know what is mutation. So mutation, it is a sudden heritable change in the genotype of a living organism. Okay? And this sudden change in the genotype of the organism, it can be caused naturally or it can be induced. That means it can be deliberately done. If it is natural, it is known as spontaneous mutation. And if it is induced deliberately, it is known as induced mutation. Now, it can be induced by the application of factors which are known as mutagens. So the factors which are actually responsible for the change in the genotype of a particular organism are known as mutagens. And these mutagens can be of three types. It can be natural mutagens, it can be chemical mutagens, it can be biological mutagens. Natural mutagens such as high temperature, high concentration of carbon dioxide, X-rays and UV rays. These are natural mutagens. Chemical mutagens like nitrous acid, EMS that is ethyl methyl sulfonate, mustard gas and colchicin. These are chemical mutagens. And then there can be biological mutagens also which can cause such mutation or changes like viruses and bacteria. Okay, so this is mutation. What is mutation? Mutation is a sudden change which is observed in the genotype of a particular species of plant or animals. So here when we are studying about plants, we'll be studying about mutation breeding in plants. So what is mutation breeding? Now mutation breeding is a deliberate action. It is a mutation which is induced for obtaining desirable characters. Okay, so the genotype of a particular plant organism or a particular plant species is deliberately changed. Okay, and they are changed by introducing or by inducing certain mutagens. So mutation breeding, it is inducing desirable mutation or desirable characters and exploiting them for crop improvement. Now this deliberate action is for crop improvement, and the crop improvement can be quality of the crop or the quantity of the crop. Now this mutation breeding, it is mainly used for self-pollinating crops. and it is used to produce traits like crops with large number of seeds or large size of seed, or you can say different colors of flowers, different colors of fruits, anything like that. So to obtain such kind of characters or such kind of traits, the mutagens are introduced into such species, and the genotype of that particular species is changed. Now, it is a process of exposing the seed. How is this process done? So it is a process of exposing the seeds to chemicals or radiations in order to generate mutants with desirable traits, and then these mutants can be bred with other cultivars. Okay, so the plants created using mutagenesis, they are known as mutagenic plants, or if the seeds are introduced, they are known as mutagenic seeds. So what happens over here? The seedlings or the seeds of a particular plant, they are irradiated by CO60 and they are exposed to UV bulb and X-ray machines. Now, as I told you that UV bulbs and X-ray machines, they are a type of physical mutagens. Okay, so such mutagens are introduced to the seeds or the seedlings of the plant. And these mutagens will cause mutations and chromosomal aberrations in the plant. Okay, and now the treated seed or the seedlings are screened for knowing they are resistant to certain disease, pest, or their yield. How much does the yield they produce? Now there are certain examples of the mutation breeding crops given over here. Jagannath variety of rice, NP836 variety of wheat, which is rust resistant. Indore 2 variety of cotton, which is having resistant to bollworm. And Regina 2 variety of cabbage, which is having resistant to bacterial rot. So these are the crops which are grown in India, and they are the result of mutation breeding. Next, let us study about the plant breeding for the development of resistance to insect pest. Now insects, they are herbivorous, and because they are herbivorous, they incur a very heavy loss in the quantity and the quality of the crops. And the resistance towards these insect pests in the crops, it can be developed by following ways. So there are about four ways. By using these four techniques, resistance in the crops can be maintained. The first one is development of morphological characters like hairy leaves in cotton. So if there is a morphological character like hairy leaf in the cotton is developed by using the process of hybridization or mutation breeding, this develops a vector resistance from the insect, which is known as jacids. So these are jacids. Okay, these are jacids. Next, in wheat, developed vector resistance to cereal leaf beetle. Okay, so wheat can develop vector resistance to cereal leaf beetle. Next, solid stem in wheat leads to resistant to stem borer. So these are stem borers. And if by the process of mutation breeding or by the process of hybridization, solid stem is developed into a wheat or a wheat crop, this can lead to a resistance to stem borers. Then there can be certain biochemical alterations as well, which can provide resistance to insects. So certain biochemical changes also provides resistance. The example that is given over here is high aspartic acid and low nitrogen and sugar content in maize. So if there is a biochemical alteration in maize of having high aspartic acid and low nitrogen and sugar content, this acts as a resistant to stem borers. Okay, these are the stem borers which actually make the stem of the crop hollow. They bore inside the stem and then they make the crop hollow. The last technique that can be used is to produce nectarless cotton. So if the cotton that is produced is nectarless and which are having smooth leaves, they develop a resistance against bollworm. These are bollworms. Now there are some pest resistant varieties of crops which are grown in India. These are the crops Brassica, and the variety that is pest resistant is Pusa Gaurav. Pusa Gaurav, they are resistant against aphids. These are aphids. Then the flat beans variety Pusa Sem 2 and Pusa Sem 3, they are resistant to the insect pests like jacids. They are jacids, aphids and fruit borers. These are fruit borers. And the crop like okra, that is ladyfinger, the variety of Pusa Savani and Pusa A4, they are resistant to insect pests like shoot and the fruit borer. So these are the, this is the fruit borer and this is the shoot borer. So Pusa Savani and Pusa A4, they are resistant to these two pests. Okay, next let us start with a new topic, that is tissue culture. So students, tissue culture, it is a growth of tissues or cells in an artificial medium. Okay, so we are over here basically studying about plant tissue culture. So in plant tissue culture, what is happening is the tissues or the cells of a plant is isolated and then they are grown into an artificial medium. So when we say it is isolated, that means it is separated from the parent organism. And this technique of plant tissue culture, it is also known as micropropagation. Now this is typically facilitated via use of liquid, semi-liquid or solid growth medium such as broth and agar. So if it is a liquid medium, it is known as broth, and if it is a solid or a semi-solid medium, it is known as an agar. Okay, so there are certain liquid mediums and solid mediums like broth and agar, which are having all the nutrients which are required for the plant growth or the tissue or the cell growth of the plant. So what happens in tissue culture? Tissue culture, it involves isolated cells, tissues, organs, and these isolated cells, tissues, organs, they are grown in vitro, which is cultured in a liquid or a solid nutrient medium. So as I told you, the broth and the agar, which will have all the nutrition. So these are the liquid or the solid nutrient medium on which these cells or the tissues or the organs are grown. And these are grown under certain controlled and aseptic conditions. When we say aseptic condition, that means a proper hygiene is maintained to avoid contamination. And controlled condition, that means controlled conditions of light, humidity and temperature. So optimum amount of light, temperature and humidity is maintained, which is required for that particular plant to grow. And the part of the plant which is used, suppose a particular cell of the plant will be used, or a particular tissue or the organ of the plant will be used. This particular part of the plant which is used for this process of tissue culture is known as explant. Okay, so using the appropriate growing conditions like optimum amount of light, humidity and temperature and the aseptic condition, each explant can be induced in the rapidly producing the shoot, and then if additional hormones, growth hormones are added to it, the roots will also be produced. Okay, now when these plants are into the growing stages, and these plants have to be separated. So if these plantlets have to be separated, they can be separated when there is a shoot stage. That means when the plant is, or the plantlet is producing shoots, at that particular stage, these plantlets can be separated and then they can be grown into different mediums. Okay. Now what will happen with this? There will be more number of plantlets that can be produced. Okay. And these plantlets, these large number of new plantlets, they can be now, when they are fully grown or when they are producing, when they have produced the shoot as well as the root, they can be now transferred into the soil where they can be grown into normal condition. So if you see in this cyclic picture, here this particular tissue or the particular organ of the plant was taken and then they were grown into this nutrient medium. Okay. And at this stage, when the shoot is being produced, they are separated. Now when they are separated, that means they are, n number, and then they can be removed from this nutrient medium and then they can be grown into a normal condition. Now, plant tissue culture, it works on the principle of totipotency. What is totipotency? It is an inherent ability of the living plant cells to grow, divide and redivide and give rise to a whole new plant. Okay, so what is totipotency? It is inherent ability of the plant cell. It can be a plant cell, it can be a plant tissue or a plant organ. When this particular plant cell, tissue or an organ is placed into a particular nutrient medium, it has an ability, inherent ability to grow, to divide and redivide and finally give rise to a new plant. This is totipotency. Okay, so plant tissue culture works on the principle of totipotency. And this plant tissue culture, this technique was first introduced or first conceived by a scientist whose name was Gottlieb Haberland in the year 1902. So he is the scientist who actually introduced the world with this technique of plant tissue culture, and he is known as the father of tissue culture. Okay. Now the medium in which the plant tissue culture takes place, or in which these plants are grown, it contains all the essential minerals, all the sources of carbohydrates, proteins and fats. With that, it also contains water, growth hormones, vitamins and agar, which is required for a proper callus culture or proper growth of that particular explant. And the most commonly preferred medium which is used for this tissue culture technique is MS medium. So Murashik and Skoog were the two scientists who actually introduced this MS medium to tissue culture. Okay, this MS medium is having all the required essential nutrients which is required for an explant to grow. Okay, and it is named after the two scientists who have actually introduced it. This scientist, his name is Murashik and his name is Skoog. So this was about the plant tissue culture. So students, we end this session over here, and in the next session we'll be studying about more about tissue culture, where we'll be studying about different types of cultures and how the aseptic and other conditions are maintained to perform the tissue culture. And then we'll move to a new topic which is known as micropropagation, which is actually a part of tissue culture.